I must be a champion. Say that. I must be a champion. I will be a champion. I will do whatever it takes to be a champion. Welcome to the video. Welcome to the video. Here we're sharing the good news. The good news. The good news is that there's never been even an instant of existence. Not even one instant, and there never will be. Okay, that is actually the great good news. Secondly, there are those who have realized this and accepted it, and they are here to help us with this. They help disseminate this good news to all of us. Thirdly, the good news is for all of us. Fourthly, you can practice this. Now, the practice consists of four different phases, four basic phases. They overlap a little bit. And these four phases help you move your comfort zone towards realization, acceptance and realization. There's never been even in one instant of existence and the realization of that you're a champion. You're a champion. Now, being a champion is not easy. For example, San Francisco Giants, champions once again of the quote-unquote baseball scene, baseball world. Underdogs the whole way. Nobody believed they would do it. 20-1 odds, and everyone said, no, you're not going to do it. Somehow, they just believed. They refused to lose. They ended up champions. It is doable. It's very important in this world for there to be outstanding examples, shining examples that transmit the good news, that we realize, wow, there's someone who there's something which is so outstanding, so shining, and they say, you know what? They're telling me that I can do it too. So those who have realized that there's never been even one instant of existence, and never will be, they tell us that we can realize this too. We can realize this too. I remember going to a golf tournament and seeing several tournaments, seeing Tiger Woods play. And it was just like, wow. At his top, when he was on top of his game. And then you realize, hey, it is possible to play really well. It is possible to play really well. And right here, he's seeing it. He's doing it. Yeah. So it's really important that society has those to look up to. Now, the good news that we are disseminating here is being countered by what I call the bad news. And what this bad news is to convince people that existence is real. And what's happening in this world now is a massive leveling influence, that everything is being homogenized and leveled down, and a massive bureaucracy is forming to implement this leveling down, where we are being told that those who realize there's never been an instant of existence are somehow mythical, somehow crazy, and this information should not be disseminated, that it produces too much instability in quote-unquote society, meaning corporate projections. And so this is a massive, massive worldwide movement. It's called the New World Order, actually. And this is undermining the dissemination of this good news. Two of the teachers that I tend to rely upon are Jesus Christ of Nazareth and Longchenpa, the great Dzogchen, Tibetan Dzogchen master. They have certainly realized that there's never been an instant of existence. And they've certainly been working to disseminate this information through various traditions in this world. The traditions are pathways of dissemination of this great good news. The Christianity is called the gospel, good news, and in Buddhism it's also called the good news. Buddha said, this is the good news I'm giving you. It is simply the good news. And the four phases are simply the phases of getting used to this good news. It's that simple. It's a gradual process of getting used to this good news. Here we think that we're bodies trapped in a world of process, time, space, process, form, existence, and contingent existence, this continuity, compulsive continuity of cycles and dynamics of nature. We think we're part of, there's a nature, we're part of this, and nature made us. None of that is true. In the same way that some elaborate dream that you're dreaming, you think that all the stuff in the dream is part of, that everything's happening in the dream, you can't escape it. You know, you have to work within the dream to somehow deal with all the factors in the dream. Not true. You can simply wake up from the dream and realize it was all equally a dream. That nothing has to happen in a dream in order to wake up from it. This is a way of putting it. Nothing has to happen in a dream in order for us to wake up from that dream, actually. However, you could also say that disseminating this good news does need to happen within the dream in order to wake up from it. Not technically, I mean, but it's very helpful. I mean, theoretically, we don't even need the good news to be disseminated because we are certainly free to wake up from it. But what I say, and what this sharing is all about, is saying that there is this block called a continuity problem, continuity fear, in that we are afraid to make this big shift into realization, like there's never been even an instant of existence. No momentum to anything. There's no such thing as what we call momentum. We're afraid to make that shift. So, there is the dissemination of this good news does need to take place in the dream from a pragmatic standpoint, not from a factual, real standpoint. It's not an absolute necessity. We're free to wake up right now. But pragmatically, we will not do that. We will not just make this huge shift, boom, without first preparing for it. The preparation, I say, takes four basic phases. And it can take a long time and a lot of work. But keep in mind that this massive effort to level us all down and say you're all just human robots here to make sure that corporate projections are all met properly, and a huge bureaucracy to manage it all, and all sorts of people scrambling for entitlements in that bureaucracy, etc. That is the future of this planet, actually. So we better do whatever we can do to keep the fire of aspiration burning within us here. To hear this good news, to get used to it. Get used to it. What is the key to success? Get used to it. Now, the Giants won their third championship in 5 years. We're used to it now in the Bay Area here. Giants fans are used to it. We knew what to expect. We know how it goes the third time. So we're calm. We're focused. We say, you know, just one step at a time. We know what happens. That sure, there's a parade. We know how to do a parade. We know how to do it. Everything is familiar to us. It makes it easier. It makes it a lot easier. So, familiarity is super important. Okay, again, familiarity is super important. The only other way is to just make the complete shift right now, and no one is going to do that. No one will do that. So familiarity. If you don't do it right now, then you tacitly are becoming familiar with something, right? With some facet of imagined existence. You're the familiarity. I'm sitting here. I'm getting familiar with where I'm sitting. It's automatically happening. Familiarity is something that automatically happens. So we either get familiar, continue our familiarity with the belief in nature, or we focus on familiarity with the realization of the good news that existence has never existed. There's never been even one instant of existence, of what we call existence in nature. Never. Now, it's such an astonishing statement that you can understand why there might be four phases towards this, right? And in history, it's always been various, you know, stages you go through. And I'm just streamlining and saying, you know, what I see is just four basic phases, actually. Four basic phases. And there are virtues to cultivate. There are along the way that help. And so that it's just a matter, the good news is helping everybody along to, towards this good news, towards full acceptance of the good news. This is the whole point of religion, of spiritual teachings of religion, helping everyone along towards this, accepting this good news. That's that. It's very simple. Very, very simple. There's never been even one instant of existence. Never will be. It's only a wishful dream, an idle wish that we have for existence. It's never existed. Existence has never existed. We have a desire for it, but it's an idle wish that doesn't actually bear, have any fruit to it at all. It's barren. It's barren. Because what is the idea of existence except the idea of changing reality? That's all that it is. Reality is what's called indeterminate, meaning absolute freedom. The Creator, God the Creator, extended itself as absolute freedom, which means that we are completely free to experience whatever we want to experience every instant. There's no such thing as a bound instant. Every instant that arises is already self-released, inherently abiding in spontaneous, concurrent release, effortless release. You could say it's already released. There's no causative, nothing that needs to cause the release. It's inherently released when, as soon as we choose another experiencing. That's when. Reality is, why I say, indeterminate, completely indeterminate, meaning one instant, what we experience in one instant is not determining the next instant at all. No two instants are bound together. So there's no such thing as process, which would be existence. There's no such thing as existence. There are not two moments bound together in any causative way whatsoever, never. Therefore, existence doesn't exist. There's never been two moments bound together. There's no such thing as existence. No such situation. Doesn't exist. It's a dream. It is a dream. It's a dream in which we're dreaming that dynamics and forces in nature are affecting, compulsively, inescapably affecting other things. And so it's a dream of determinism. But the dreamer of that dream is not bound by the dream in the slightest bit. So they are free this instant to stop dreaming the dream. Every instant they're completely free to stop dreaming the dream as though it never arose in the first place. You see, gone, something else. We're completely free to do that. So we are spirit. We are indeterminate. A dream of determinacy does not make spirit determinate. This is like a wishful imagination of wanting to make ourselves determinate. But the dream never makes us determinate. The dream does not change the dreamer. Okay, this is very important good news to know. The dream does not change the dreamer. The content of the dream does not change the dreamer one bit. And it never will. So, with this in mind, this very instant, exactly the way this dream is presenting itself, realize that the dreamer does not have to keep dreaming this dream. Is not bound at all by God, by reality. Perfectly free to drop this whole dream this very instant. Therefore, how much determinacy is there in this dream, really? The determinacy of this dream, supposed determinacy that we think is actually caused by our absolute freedom to continue to dream it each instant. You see? And that's not determinacy. That is just our choice, our free choice, our free will. And sometimes we just need to stop and be shocked by what we're saying, what we're hearing. purpose of these thieves is to forge forward into this is practice where we try to ring the bell, you know, really ring the bell of wow, the bell of wowism, where you just, no matter what, where you're at on the path, going through these phases of accepting the good news, there's always going to be something that is going to wow you, to stagger you. It's like, wow, just staggered by it. This is the whole point of practice. It's not to see if you can avoid being staggered. It's to find out how you can stagger yourself in the right way. I remember in the earlier phases, like phase two, I was desperately trying to figure out, how can I avoid being staggered? I gotta learn all this teaching so I can keep from being staggered. But in the fourth phase, now you're intentional, you want to be staggered. Okay, so there are differences in the phases, most definitely there are differences. This is fourth phase, these videos are fourth phase because of the urgency of the times. For example, the urgency of the times is such that forging ahead with this fourth phase is what I'm doing. But it is true that in other phases, you'll have a different orientation in terms of you're trying not to be staggered. I'm trying not to be staggered. Eventually, it turns around in the fourth phase and you're saying, wow, I love being staggered like this. This is great. Because you have the poise to deal with this now, and you realize you're not going to go crazy or insane or collapse or fall apart or anything like that. You don't get freaked out by it. Whereas in the earlier phases, you can get freaked out by your mind is playing tricks, can play tricks and freak itself out, most definitely. So the path is not easy going. The four phases are not easy at all, but we have to till that land. And so having examples of those who've done it is super important. And society needs to be stratified and set up in that way where we understand where we're at, where we have spiritual discernment of where we're at. Okay? And where we're in a discernment of progress, and discernment of those who have gone on before us, and discernment of those who have succeeded. This is how society needs to be set up for progress. And instead, we're getting the opposite now in this world, where spiritual discernment is basically having the rug pulled out from underneath it. The basic tool in this world is spiritual discernment. That is the basic tool. And we are teaching everybody to go about without any tool at all, just rely on the bureaucracy to solve your problems. Remember, our problem is the belief in existence. How is the bureaucracy going to solve that problem for anyone? Bureaucracy has its place, but it has to know its place. We have to know its place. Governance has its place. Education has its place. All that has its place. But we have to know what its place is, you see. And that comes from transmission of the good news from those who know what it's all about. And that spiritual discernment is absolutely necessary. Now, I've gone through this whole battle the last 58 years in this world of trying to maintain spiritual discernment, and it's been incredibly difficult. The countercurrents are like a massive tide against this. Basically, what we're doing with our time is using any and all pretext to turn away from spiritual discernment. We're trying to distract ourselves from a world without spiritual discernment is ripe for being taken over. It's like a forest that is with no water, severe drought. What happens? They lose their immunity. The trees lose their immunity, and in come the beetles, the bugs, the borers. Before you know it, the whole forest is dead. Now we're seeing this happen in large swaths of forest land all over the world with this shifting of climate. Whatever the cause may be, there is some shifting of climate going on. Lowering of immunity results in collapse. I'm reminded of the Kham region of Tibet, eastern Tibetan area, where the people were being starved and Mao's Great Leap Forward. And their immunity got so bad, they had no food to eat, that when someone would catch a cold, the cold would spread like wildfire, and thousands of people would die from that one cold. Just they had no resistance, no immunity, okay? So here we are in the world thinking everything is fine, like, but our spiritual immunity is dropping. Our spiritual discernment is being sabotaged in this world. No question about it. Then those with spiritual discernment are certainly aware of this, that like, wow, there's all this stuff that is very inimical to my spiritual discernment, that is trying to pull my attention away from it and very cleverly involving me in all this agitation, you know, that's not helpful. So it is being sabotaged, and this lowers our immunity, spiritual immunity, so we're not able to fend off aggressive pushes by global bureaucracy that is, that doesn't have our best interests in mind at all. It has global corporate interests really in mind, okay? That's where the money is, that's where the power is. Banks, the corporations, they want a homogenized sheeple, basically, who are incapable of spiritual discernment. And they're doing everything possible to bring this about, and they're being very successful, actually. Let us not sugarcoat it. They're being very successful, unfortunately. Spiritual discernment. You might as well, in this realm of that we, in the situation we're in with a severe continuity fear, you might as well call it your life. That's your life. Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body. Fear those who can kill your what? Spirit? But he's saying spiritual discernment. The spirit can't be killed. Obviously cannot. Spirit is deathless, birthless, deathless, eternal, formless. What Jesus was saying is those who could kill spiritual discernment, those are the ones who are really dangerous. And those are the ones that have seized control of this planet and continue to consolidate their control over it. And I say this consolidation will basically be finished by July of 2016, where people will tacitly accept this leveling down, the sheeple status as normal, the lack of spiritual discernment as actually a great accomplishment. This is how it's being marketed, is we're being told that the lack of spiritual discernment is some ultimate accomplishment. Very difficult accomplishment. And people are buying into this, thinking, yeah, if I just get my attention away from spiritual discernment, that means there isn't anything to discern. This is Orwellian flipping, of, right? This is the brave new world that we're entering. New World Order is that the conclusion the world will reach is that if I don't have any spiritual discernment, that must mean, ergo, must mean there's nothing to discern. Poof, magical solution to the continuity fear. Or so they think. But the continuity fear is lingering there. Well, just is there. Just there. And people will feel it like this dread, this great threat somewhere, this amorphous, free-floating anxiety, amorphous threat. I don't know what it is. And they'll take more and more pills to calm down. They say, wow, I don't know what this is. I don't have any spiritual discernment, therefore there's nothing to discern. So there shouldn't be anything. I should be happy. But there's something somewhere. I don't know what it is. It's bugging me. Oh, it's okay, they'll say. Just here. I have this pill for you. That should calm you down. Breathe. Relax. Be a nice, good sheepo. You're a fine sheepo. So, the four phases are just the usage of your spiritual discernment and the exercise, and it gets stronger and stronger and stronger as you go along. So even to the point where you can ultimately realize that there's never, ever, ever been even one moment of existence, not one instance of existence. There's only the holy instant of perfect freedom, which is never bound, is never a product of the past, and is never a precursor of the future. Now, in a sane society, these four phases will not be in conflict with one another. What's happening with this global corporate bureaucracy is to divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. Set these different phases against each other. Set the religions against each other. Set the phases against each other. Except like that. Divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. Divide and conquer is what they do. Bring as much chaos as possible, which then justifies the bureaucracy stepping in even more so, right? But those who have spiritual discernment are pretty much self-governing, all right? They're pretty much self-governing. They don't want a bureaucracy. They don't want all these rules and regulations, all right? They're very much self-governing. The further you go, the more self-governing you feel. And you say, you feel, I don't need all this tight restrictions, regulations, do this. I'm listening to the Holy Spirit within. I'm listening to spiritual discernment within. I'm mature. I'm not some child that needs to be completely controlled all the time. So, of course, there's an antithesis towards this massive bureaucratic octopus. So we don't need it. We don't need it. But this divide and conquer strategy, exploiting our weaknesses in this world, exploiting our continuity fear instead of evaporating it, has led the world into this nasty trap. Now, people differ in their evaluation of this, of course. I tend to say it's very severe, very severe. Now, in Christian theology, it is founded upon an urgency. Christian theology is founded upon an urgency. Now, if you look at Buddhist teachings, for instance, Longjianpa's teachings, you will find that he brings tremendous urgency to it, saying you must get free of the cycles of birth and death. And there's not so much eschatology about talking about the end times and then the situation that's arising now, this corporate bureaucracy taking over the world. There's not so much of that. Whereas Christianity is very heavy on that. Christianity says basically that the world is trending in a certain direction, and at a certain time, the end of this age, end of the cycle, it will go into this very, very bad situation where even the saints, the elect of God, those who are very far along are in danger of losing their spiritual discernment. This is what we've been told. So Christianity has at its root this tremendous urgency. Christians have always been very urgent, like we need to get this done. And Lakjepa, in his teachings, Dzogchen Buddhist teachings, said, also has the saying, look, this life is super valuable. You must use it to receive the good news. Do not squander it. It is supremely important. If you squander it, it will have very bad effects upon you, and you will be pulled down into reoccurring cycles of birth and death, so, you know, basically put the fear into you, like, wow, you better get after this. And so the urgency is there too, although it's not eschatological urgency about, you know, there's going to come a time, you know, centuries down the road, where you better have gotten free, or else you're going to really be pulled down. But nevertheless, the urgency is there, it's there, it's there. Christianity, the urgency is most certainly there, and we, most Christians, realize that these are the end times right now. These are the times that we've been warned about. And other traditions also have similar eschatological warnings. These are the times we've been warned about. So we most certainly have this intensity of urgency, so we don't lose our spiritual discernment. As you know, maybe I should do a person on the street type of video where I just ask people at random, can you tell me, what's your definition of spiritual discernment? And see what they say. I bet that most people would stumble and fumble and bumble, and they'd realize, oh my gosh, I'm not really sure anymore. I thought I knew. I'm sure that everybody walking along this world today thinks they have spiritual discernment, because what we're being told by this corporate, I call it corporate princess culture, it's really been driven that way. It's how it's being marketed, is that to lose spiritual discernment is to gain freedom. From what we're told, that this dread that we have, which is really continuity fear, but nobody says that. I'm one who's saying that, but it's not something that's commonly said at all. It's not recognized what it is. But we're told that to lose our spiritual discernment, this dread, this inner fear, which is really continuity fear, will disappear. And we'll be liberated, we'll be happy, live happy ever after. This is the big lie. Okay, this is the big lie. The lie of the ego. Christianity, we call it the lie of Satan or Lucifer. Of Course in Miracles called the lie of the ego. I say it's an expression of our continuity fear. We're so scared that we're telling ourselves, hey, we don't even need to deal with this. If we just get rid of spiritual discernment, there'll be nothing to discern, and poof, it's gone. It doesn't work that way. So we're being led down the primrose path into darkness, actually. Spiritual darkness, which is just a waste of time. The discernment is always within us, but we have to turn towards it and use it. It's like the light is there, we just have to uncover it. But if we cover it, it's all dark, you know. We think it's all dark, but that's because we're covering the light. If I cover these lights, you know, like this, it gets dark, right? And then just uncover it, the lights are there. We never get rid of that. The good news is within us. We are what we are. We are spirit. I'm not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me to be. Absolutely 100% still spirit. Totally free. Everyone is. All is that. All is that. All is that. So at first it's a feigned attraction. Phase one is this feigned attraction. You recognize an attraction. Your spiritual discernment says, you know what? I believe what the good and the good news, but I can't really quite integrate it. You know, I can't quite place it. You know, so, but there's something within you. Say, yeah, I know. There's something. There is freedom from death. I know there is. You know, this is like phase one. I don't. There's some sort of freedom. I'm not really sure how, but I just know there is, and it comes from spiritual discernment. There has to be spiritual discernment involved. Whereas in this corporate princess culture of the New World Order, it's saying you don't get rid of spiritual discernment, and then you won't have any more anxiety, and then you'll truly enjoy being a body. That's what they tell you. Being a body, you'll say, wow, I never realized how great being a body is, you know. And using all these products, oh my God, these products are going to make my body even better. This is great. Now, we may be saying, wow, this is this is what's happening in the world. It is a big wow. It's a shaking, like, holy cow. That the ultimate virtue is being held up in this world is to shed all spiritual discernment entirely and go on what's called the instinct of the body. The wisdom of the body is what it's called. The wisdom of the body. In that state, you're easily hypnotized, programmable by marketing and advertising and social pressure, etc. Easy. You're like a sheep. You're a sheep, essentially. There's no essential difference between you and a sheep or cattle. No essential difference at all in that situation. You're easily herded. The shepherd easily herd the sheep. Just, hey, you know, the sheepdog, rah, 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 barking all the time. Oh, and you go, oh, okay. You can't say Christmas, rah, 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 rah. You said Christmas, rah, 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 rah. Don't order me. Okay. What do you want me to say? Holiday season. Holiday season it is. Instant nirvana. Just say the word, it's instant nirvana. I said holiday season. Ah, my fear is gone. Well, the fear of repercussions may be abated, but the continuity fear towards realizing that there's never been even an instant of existence, that hasn't gone anywhere. That hasn't gone anywhere. And so what happens is you keep transferring this fear into all these little niggling details, and the bureaucracy is never ending, whacking them all. This fear is popping up here. There's one over here. Let's get rid of this one. And it's just really your continuity fear bubbling through. Every time it bubbles through, it's misidentified and projected upon some situation. Like, hey, we can't say Christmas anymore. That's really bad. Oh, that's our problem. We're saying Christmas. Okay, holiday season. Saved. Saved. Corporate bureaucracy has saved me. Thank you, corporate bureaucracy. We're not worthy. We're not worthy. We're not worthy of that. Are you kidding me? It's magic, huh? Absolute magic. And it goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on like that. Because this continuity fear keeps leaking through. And then you're saying, like, I've done everything right, you know? I've got rid of all my signs of spiritual discernment, vacated everything. I'm politically correct to the utmost. So I should be happy, but I'm feeling all jittery and nervous, and I don't know why. I have no idea why. And then they say, well, you're suffering from post-spiritual discernment syndrome. So here, we have some medicine for you. We should try this combination of this and this, and we'll work on this with you and take all these medications. They say, yeah, but the medications are making me feel even worse. And they say, well, you give you some time to adjust to it. Be and do this. Nobody ever says, hey, your problem is that you've tried to throw away your spiritual discernment. they say, you just need to meet the right person, right? Need the right person. Go out and have fun. You're not having enough fun. Come on, be diverse, have fun. Just, you know, what are you doing? They never say your problem is you've turned away from spiritual discernment. When you turn back to spiritual discernment, then you realize, holy cow, I've been hoodwinked. And you realize, hey, I do have a way to get free of my suffering. I most certainly do have a way, and it's following this path of spiritual discernment is the way. I do have a way to be a champion. It's a long season, but it ends with the championship. Envision the championship. Envision the championship. Or as Hunter Benn says, envision the parade. Envision the parade, everybody. envision the parade. So these examples, those who have done it, you know, envision yourself that you can be like them. One day you will be like them. Jesus told us, one day we will be like him. Absolutely. The real teachers say, you will be the same as me for sure. They don't place themselves saying, you will never attain to what I am. So don't even bother. They say, no, you definitely will. There's no question about it, because you will realize too, there's never been an instant of existence. There's never been, even one never will be. You are completely free as I am completely free. I am completely free. All is completely free. Forever and ever and ever. There's no status at all in reality. All is perfectly free. It's all equal status. The extension of God is equal in status to God, but the only difference is God is not an extension of the extension. You can't reverse the direction of creation like that. Which is what we tried to do. We thought we could see if we could do that. And this is give rise to the belief in an existence, which doesn't exist. Existence doesn't exist. Existence has never existed. Now, it's very important to keep a sense of humor. Okay. Whatever phase you're in receiving this good news, keep a sense of humor. Even if it's gallows humor. Always have a chuckle, a little chuckle, a little smile, and try not to get, you know, morose about it. This tends to open up the door more and more and more to insight, you see, into receiving the good news. Because you're not all tightened up about it. Just little joke. This is good. This is great. The future is terrible. Says, of course it is. Absolutely it is. Yes, we know that. It's a smile. I don't intend to be pulled down in that at all. Because we tend to get locked into this belief that we're being taught in the world now that to have spiritual discernment is a sin. What's the one sin in this all diversified, all tolerant, big mother corporation world that we're in, and the nanny state bureaucracy is what? The sin is spiritual discernment. That's the one unforgivable, unpardonable sin. Anybody expressing spiritual discernment at all is crushed by the Goliath, by the juggernaut. Remorseless, relentless juggernaut just crushes anyone who dares express spiritual discernment in a broad way. For instance, if somebody on television, you know, you get someone who does have some spiritual discernment and it slips out, you know, whoops, you know, everyone goes, you know, the whole media acts like lemmings. It's like they're all just puppets and the puppeteers just, you know, cause them all to react and say, spiritual discernment. And so, how dare you? Twitterverse blows up. Social media is a bully, okay? Let's be honest, social media is a bully. And social media just bullies him into oblivion. Because their purpose is to bully us all into oblivion. Oh, our Facebook friends are unfriending us. Oh my God. Hey, if you don't have any friends, you don't have any to lose, you see? This is one of my secrets. I don't have any friends. Don't have any friends to lose. So I can say what I want to say. I'm not going to worry about losing friends. This is part of the advice of longevity, as a matter of fact. But all these, we're being taught to have all this network of friends. Why? To bully us. They're like the Red Guard, you know? They're, you know, watching our every move, watching our, whatever we say, monitoring whatever we say, to try to help everybody to drop their spiritual discernment is what is taking place in this world. So, occasionally, someone in the media drops some spiritual discernment. Even a little bit of common sense. They say, hey, folks, you know, two sides of this story, folks. Total freak out. I mean, what are we living among? Two-year-olds here in the world? I think everybody's being dumbed down to this stage of a two-year-old here. Some very young juvenile and crying to mommy or somebody. You know, I'm just so upset. Somebody use common sense. Oh, spiritual discernment, absolute crisis. Whole world crisis. My God. How easy is it to start a crisis in this world? There's a million ways and a million more. All you have to do is like utter some word, you know, in the wrong place, the wrong time, and the world will just like go completely berserk. Fired. Your life is over. Your life is over, you know, is what the bullies say. I say, well, whatever. There's a saying, Christians say, what a friend we have in Jesus, okay? So they don't really care, you know, what society says or whatever. They say, look, my friend is Jesus. And as long as he cares about me, all's good. So it's good to have friends in high places in this world. Friends, those who have realized there's no such thing as existence. It's good to have those kind of friends. Absolutely it is. Your great friend is spiritual discernment, actually. That is your buddy, that is your friend, that is indispensable. It is indispensable. And we're told that it's totally dispensable. In fact, dispensing with it is like, we're told it's like taking out an appendix or something. That we're getting rid of something useless. Some vestigial archetype that is, some mythical archetype that based on some sort of ancient insanity, some sort of genetic defect. We're being told that the spiritual discernment is actually a genetic defect. Did you know that? Yeah, of course. You know, they're working on that right now in the biotech labs of the Silicon Valley, figuring out which genes are causing that defect of spiritual discernment. If I get rid of that, then I'll be programmed with algorithms, and Google will tell us what the future is, you know? Great. That should fix everything. Evening tonight. Wow. As always. And when the evening comes, everything stills down, calms down, quiets down, you know. Sort of like in the world when this corporate bureaucracy descends upon the world. everyone. Quiet down. So what happens is, in the media, entertainment, everyone you see, you know, in public figures, okay, they avoid any indication they have any spiritual discernment, as if it were the kiss of death, if they were ever to indicate they have it. And so we're getting all these examples, all these role models, whose very purpose is to showcase no spiritual discernment and say, hey, look at how popular I am. Look at all the followers I have on Facebook and Twitter, etc. Look how popular, look how rich, etc. Oh, wow. And see, this is how you do it. This is how you do it. And this overwhelming message has gotten out to the masses and permeated from the intellectuals all the way down through the whole society, and has permeated society. Now, we can still remain with the words of spiritual words. They don't really care about that. It's not that important at this point. As long as the discernment isn't there. So we can read, we can still book, and, you know, read the Holy Bibles, but we're told that without the Holy Spirit, we will not be able to discern what's being said, which is very true. In other words, spiritual discernment is integral to the spiritual path. Absolutely, there is no path without it. So without spiritual discernment, we just have the form of religion without the religion. Basically, we have Lenin in a casket, you know, frozen in some, you know, embalmed in a casket. So everybody can go look at Lenin in a casket. Wow. He's just embalmed. You know, we have this embalmed religion. People think they're practicing religion. There's no religion without spiritual discernment. Religion is a moving our comfort zone towards realization. And that can't be done without spiritual discernment. Cannot be done. Cannot be done without spiritual discernment. No way, no how. So what is the curriculum of the world? Spiritual discernment. What is being completely ignored in by the world? Spiritual discernment. And those who practice that are being ostracized at an alarming rate. Faster than the dodo bird being killed off. Carrier pigeons everywhere. The media is using, you know, shotguns. Boom, 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 boom. Blow as many out of the sky as possible. They're creating panics. They're creating crises. Even when a little kid says something, now everybody freaks out, right? I mean, the pressure is down, even now, down to children. Like, you went to school in kindergarten and you brought a little show and tell with Jesus or something. Oh my God, this is like completely ruining, destroying our entire educational system. We're going to put your parents in jail. We're going to severely punish them. This should never happen again. I don't know how this happened. Complete freak out through the whole, you know, planetary freak out because some five-year-old brought a cross to school or something, you know. This is what's happening. So even the young people are being targeted. It's completely brutal. I'm sure the Red Guards are looking at this and say, oh my God, we were nothing compared to this. This is amazing. Who wants us to be all these sheep? Oh, well, we know that story. Big business is actually bigger than we realize. Okay, this is very important to know. Big business is bigger than we realize because it extends beyond this planet. As a matter of fact, this is the little secret that is oozing out of the cracks all the time, you know, has been for quite some time. that big business on this planet actually extends beyond this planet. Hello, welcome to the 21st century. So it's a really big business. You're not just messing with big business, you're messing with a really big business here. It's no longer the business of this planet is business, it's the business of this cosmos is business. Business of this galaxy is business. So this is what, you know, the realization of this seeps into us bit by bit by bit, and we're dissuaded from it, you know, but it is a fact. There's a heavy, hot and heavy relationship between this planet, big business on this planet, and business extending beyond this planet. Absolutely there is. Yeah, of course they don't really talk about it much. Might make the sheep restless, you know, in some way. Like, huh. You know, expand the horizons a little bit. Now, this super big business, of course, is something that those who are aware that there's no such thing as of existence, they're certainly aware of this. They're aware of how the cosmos works, what's going on in the cosmos. Of course they are. And so that's why they warned us, hey, there'll be a time in this world where the big business of this world will become a really big business, and the business will extend beyond this world. And at that time, you're going to get this influence in this world of this really big business taking charge of the big business of this world, which is what has happened. The ideology, the really big business is saying, this is how we run stuff, folks. This is how you're going to run stuff now. And everybody says, oh, okay, you know. Yeah. And they say, step one, got to get rid of spiritual discernment, folks. If you want to, you got to run business our way. You got to get rid of spiritual discernment. These are the new corporate rules. You know, this is the rules for society. You don't dare say this or that or think this way. They say, you don't dare be intelligent. You don't have common sense. You don't say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe there's two sides to this situation. Maybe things are not so cut and dried about you, this and this and that, you know. You know, oh, no, 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 no. This is the official super big business policy. So this planet is being run by a policy that isn't even from this planet. It extends beyond this planet. It's from the super big business that their policy has now extended into this planet. And some people don't get this, but some do. Some do. This adds an extra layer of urgency, and this is what we have been warned about previously, especially in Christian eschatology, is that there will come this time, and it has already occurred. And the tide is already high, and I'm saying the tide will reach its heights in July of 2016. Will be a super high tide then. You see, we talk about high tides and then super, super high tides. Super, super high tides change the landscape significantly, right? There are instances, for instance, what was that, Sandy in the East Coast, how it really fundamentally shifted a lot of stuff there. You know, it's really had a profound impact. Yeah, so, but a high tide of getting rid of spiritual discernment, when the tide gets really high, people can be easily stampeded into making a shift where they suddenly feel without spiritual discernment. And this is now seen as simply the way it is. This is now being a normal human being. They say, this is now normal. This is the new normal. And they say, ah, we made it. We now have the new normal. Finally, they say, finally, I'm finally normal. Got rid of this abnormality that I've been carrying around all these years. We're told that all these thousands of years we're carrying around this terrible abnormality of spiritual discernment. And finally, they say, finally. So, there is a tide in the affairs of humankind, isn't there, as Shakespeare said. Absolutely there is. There most definitely are ties. I say the annexation, invasion of Tibet is one of those. Kicking the Tibetans out of Tibet, essentially. Certainly has had a dramatic effect on the world. Spiritually, you know, where some good, some bad. But I would say, all in all, I look at it positive in that it certainly put pressure on us for spiritual discernment. Okay, it certainly did. Now, our response to that has been uneven, for sure. But overall, I would say that this urgency it may have been a blessing in disguise for the world, because Tibetans are very urgent in their spiritual practice, are very intense. This is their culture. It's a monastic culture, basically. And so that intensity started disseminating throughout the world, you know, and so we've been reacting to that in subtle ways that people don't realize is actually way more profound than we realize. Lit a fire under a lot of people. It says, whoa, what is this stuff? I don't get this. What's going on here? My discernment doesn't reach there, you know? Because a lot of that stuff is very advanced. I mean, there is radical Dzogchen, and Tibet is very advanced teaching, to say the least. It's the highest teaching. Yeah, we struggle with that. We struggle. What are they talking about? I don't get it. Of course, some of them don't get it either. And they're not getting it also got into us, you know, for sure. Not every Tibetan says talks about Dzogchen actually gets it at all. Absolutely not. But there is some. There is this undercurrent. Okay, that is very profound. Very profound. And so this lit a fire, and you know, the one who wrote, who was instrumental in publishing the book I Am That by Srinivasagarada Maharaj, his name escapes me at this moment, but he actually was helpful in helping the government of India accept the Tibetan refugees and take care of them. Pretty amazing. One of the unsung heroes of the world. It's hard anybody knows his name, but some of you can look it up, you know. Google it. Google is your friend in that instance. And so this has reverberated. This has reverberated. And it's been, I think, a net positive for the world. A net positive. We can talk about the negatives, but it's a net positive. Huge challenge. Huge challenge. Certainly difficult, because there was a lot of wheeling and dealing, spiritual wheeling and dealing going on, right? It's very confusing. Very, very confusing. But now we're tying the transmission lines together, and I'm saying, hey, Jesus, Bible, Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, Radical Dzogchen, Longchenpa, for instance, that transmission, it's the same. It's the same. It's the same. So we're no longer so adrift here. We're no longer so adrift, actually. I'm telling you, the last 60 years have been extremely challenging here. So if you're listening to this video, those of you that are, obviously, if you're hearing this, you get this sense of it is tied together. It has been tied together. It is not a confusion anymore. You don't need to feel intimidated or confused by the situation. You can get above it. And I'm trying to just present this unified expression, you know, And that helps you calm down, actually, because we've been through some turbulent water, to say the least. Trying to make heads and tails of what in the world is going on spiritually on this planet. It's enough to drive anyone crazy. Or at least stress them out so badly that they feel like they can't pull it together. But it's being pulled together here, thanks to many, 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 many helping out in this world. Many and many, many helping out. So this is just one of the avenues of help here that I'm just blessed enough to be able to share. Just one of many avenues of help where we're starting to say, hey, you know, we're not going to be divided and conquered by corporate big, super big business. We're not going to get caught up in this division, divide and conquer thing, okay? The good news of Buddha is the good news of Jesus. The good news of Jesus is the good news of Buddha, etc., etc., etc. And that is, there's never been even one instant of existence. It's the same good news. There isn't any other good news. That is it. That is it. However you get to the oasis in the middle of the desert, all camels are welcome to drink at the pond there. All camels, no matter what direction they came from. So we're all are welcome to drink of this good news. No matter what tradition, whatever your back tradition is. So there's only one good news. The way it's been disseminated could be many, but the good news is still exactly the same. It's like someone discovers an oasis in the desert and they go out telling everybody, hey, there's water here, you know, and they tell everybody that everybody in the desert, they're searching for water. And everyone, they says, there's this drink, you can drink, and they say, oh, you mean this, and each one needs, oh, you mean this, you mean that, you mean, they have a different way of referring to water, and they say, yeah, when they all get to the oasis and drink of the water, then they all know, oh, this is what we all wanted, it's the same for all of us, it's the same for all of us, this is what we all wanted. We all wanted to realize that existence doesn't exist. That we cannot change reality, we cannot change what we are, and all efforts to do so are null and void. They never did anything. The dreamer has not been changed by the dream of changing the dreamer. Has not been changed. It can never be changed. So we all want this realization, and we just the dissemination as it trickles down. You know, it is described differently. There's a cascade, there's a waterfall, here's a fast-moving stream, here's a slow-moving stream, you know, all these different descriptions, but it's all water, it's all water. So we thank everybody who's helping out with this dissemination in whatever form. I've come across countless forms of this in various different ways. And it's always different. You know, you say, well, that's not what I expected, but it's something is there. You know, something is there. Sure. Absolutely. Now, there is this belief that spiritual discernment will win out in this world. Okay. I'm not so sure about that. That's not exactly what I'm seeing. What I'm seeing is spiritual discernment, people making deals, saying, hey, swap it for this. hey, you know, people have spiritual discernment. They're being told, hey, you can't really have it anymore, but, you know, I'll tell you what, let's make a deal. We'll swap it for something else. We'll, you know, you can have this wonderful relationship or, you know, with someone, right? Who's really with it, you know, who's really into their body, knows how what it's like to be into their body, and you can have a relationship with that, and that'll make you really happy. You know, you won't miss spiritual sermon at all. You'll have this real amazing person who's so totally in touch with their instincts and their human nature and all this stuff that, yeah, you won't, and all the stuff you can get and things you can get, you know, you won't miss it. And sure, you can still use the words and whatever, but after a while, you probably won't be that interested in it. You know, they say die and you'll have a thousand virgins or something. Whatever, die for this cause. You know, throw away spiritual sermon, you'll be rewarded with infinite maidens. You know, who will bring great bliss to you forever. You know, just agree that you're a body, and we'll take care of the body. Don't worry, you'll make a happy body. So it's quite an issue. What's going on in the world spiritually, how much of it is this deal-making, this taking place? And how many of those who are advanced in spiritual discernment are being pressured and saying, hey, listen, if you just drop the spiritual discernment angle of this, we'll promote you and you'll have, like, you know, a million beautiful, smiling bodies worshiping you as an idolizing you. You know, this is all the kind of deal making that's going on in this world, the pressure. Now, one of the problems is they're also being pressured to say, if you don't do this, we'll take all of your followers away. Quote unquote followers, those are listening to you. Now, in my case, don't have any friends, don't have any really quote-unquote followers, you know, or idolizers or anything like that. People are free to watch the videos or not watch the videos. I have no control over that whatsoever. Nobody's blocked. Nobody's special, you know, so not much they can take away. Press will go, and someone will go to them and say, listen, you know, we want to give you a lot of good publicity. What you're doing is great, but if you just make, you know, a little adjustment here, adjustment there, and you can just, you know, play along with us, we'll really publicize you and say, hey, everybody, come see this teacher. This teacher's really great. And there'll be all these wonderful, nubile people, bodies, you know, they're just like saying, good, you know, this is, we're so happy we're here. You know, we're so happy you're here to teach us how to be even more happy. How to be happy as a body, how to be happy as a human person, as a person. Personal happiness. So if you just, you know, tweak things this way and that way, you know, good plug. If you don't do that, you know, we've got some people coming to see you, and we've interviewed them, and they said, well, you know, you might have done some inappropriate stuff or said something inappropriate, or sort of a rumor floating around. You might, you know, we can kind of start floating these rumors, kind of people who give a bad smell to the whole situation, and poof, there goes everybody. That's the pressure, that's the spiritual politics of the day. On a really big scale, on a really big scale. So the question of, you know, how high will the high tide be is, it's I believe it's likely to be extremely high. Already is, actually. It's already submerging. It's already like a flood. The Holy Spirit has helped me out greatly. I don't have any friends. I don't have any followers. I don't have anything to lose, really. It may be a curse at this time to have a whole bunch to lose, because then you can be, that can be used as leverage against you. And you kind of tell everybody, hey, guess what, you know, let's stop our spiritual discernment there. Spiritual discernment is a living force within us. It's not something static. It's awareness right now. And you can't just, quote unquote, stop it. To stop it is to drop it. Spiritual discernment is attracting us to the good news. It's an ongoing attraction. You cannot have it as a static. When it becomes static, you lose your spiritual discernment. And you become ultimately very vulnerable towards buying into the belief that with no spiritual discernment, that means there's nothing to discern, which means you shouldn't be experiencing this continuity fear. Right? And saying, well, I don't have a continuity fear then. This must be something that someone is bothering me. I'm not being politically correct enough. I need some medication. I'm, you know, like that. Comes up as anxiety, depression, all these problems. So what's the key? Familiarity. Spiritual discernment. And become familiar with where that leads you. It keeps leading you. You keep getting familiar. You know, it keeps bringing you, attracting you more and more to the good news. Existence doesn't exist. More and more. It's never existed. There's never been existence. Existence has never existed. Again, because the dream of existence is totally based on the dreamer's freedom to imagine the dream of existence, you see. Instant by instant by instant by instant by instant. So no matter what arises in the dream of apparent determinacy, it's all completely indeterminate, actually. 100%. Next moment, the whole dream is vanished. Okay, so there's no real determinacy in a dream of determinacy. None whatsoever. Also keep in mind, no matter what phase you're in, bring yourself, let go of what you think you know, let yourself be impacted by something fresh, get to the wow, no matter where you're at, you have to get to the wow, even if you're super advanced, you have to get to the wow, somehow, like, wow, this is new territory, wow, I didn't see it before, wow, this changes everything, wow, and the wow will be there until the recognition is, you know, has come, realization has come. The wow will be there. So if the realization has not arrived, that means there's still some wow factor that we need to get to. Wow factor we need to get to. Now, of course, the top teachers, the ones who've gotten there, they know how to bring that out, the wow factor, you know, out of us, right? Absolutely they do. That's why sometimes someone very advanced will go to a teacher and they'll say, you know, I've been doing this my whole life. I still haven't got it. You know, there's nothing, I don't know what's wrong. I feel like I'm ready. I've been ready for. And they'll come up and the student will say, the one on the path will say, the pilgrim will say, oh, wow. How did I miss that? That's incredible. Or that's amazing. Wow. And then they may have that, you know, the realization may dawn upon them, or may be seen, absolutely accepted. There isn't any existence. Wow. Wow, wow, and wow. So of course we tend to hide from teachers, absolutely. We're afraid of them, right? Of course, because they're going to bring up this wow for sure. So a prayer, a good prayer to use is to just pray for spiritual discernment, Holy Spirit, whatever you want to call it, grace of God. Make sure that I get maximum wow factor today. This is your job. This is what I'm asking. This is what I accept from you. Make sure I get maximum wow factor today. Absolutely all important. And you will get it. You will get it when you really ask that and mean it and determine. You will get it. You will get it. Don't ask for to meet a guru today. I've never had success like that. Just ask for maximum wow factor. Because this is ultimately what you're asking to meet a guru. What's that? You're asking for maximum wow factor. So just ask for maximum wow factor, however it may come. Maybe it'll come in terms of the guise of a teacher, maybe a circumstance, something taking place, something that grabs your attention, some insight, something. Somehow it'll dawn upon you like, wow. Hadn't seen that before, hadn't recognized that before. Wow. Like that. Don't say, well, if a teacher doesn't come along, I'm not going to do anything. No, don't do that. Just say, whatever way it wants to come about, let it come about in whatever way is suitable for me. Because each situation is unique. So whatever way is suitable, Holy Spirit, bring about maximum wow factor today. Maximum wow factor. It's the most I can handle today, right now. And just keep that prayer going. Keep that prayer going. Keep that prayer going. And you, in that way, you will escape the clutches of those who are lying, the big lie of telling you that getting rid of spiritual discernment will mean that there's nothing to discern, which means there's no, how could there be any continuity here? This is magical thinking. Magical thinking. It doesn't work. Okay, that magical thinking doesn't work. We need to escape the clutches of this magical thinking and actually get the job done. Actually, so ask for maximum wow factor right now, today. Whatever way it comes, it doesn't matter how it comes. I'm not picky how it comes. Just like I prayed for the world, compassion for the world. I said, help the world. I said, the world, we need help so bad. I say, I don't care in what form it comes at all. Makes no difference to me. Whoever, whatever can respond, please respond right now. And that very night, I had this meeting while my body was sleeping, while my gross consciousness was so-called in sleep. I had the meeting with Longchenpa, the great Dzogchen master. That's who showed up. I didn't know who it was. I had no idea who it was. But I didn't put any restrictions. I said, however he wants to show up, help show up, let it show up right now. I don't care. I don't care how it shows up, what form it is at all. I don't care at all. So this is a very successful prayer. So I don't care what form it shows up in. I just pray for maximum wow factor today. See? And if you do that, you will get it. You will get it. And then, of course, practice full stop in the wow. You just sit quietly like we're doing here. See, I'm not getting up, am I? I'm just continuing to sit here. This is the key. This is the right use of the body, is to sit quietly like this. Not striking a pose, but you know that there's continuity because your body's not going to be doing anything. See, it's very important. Just full stop in the wow. The more you pray, the more you experience the wow, the better you get at handling more and more wow factor. And then you go through the phases this way. So may all beings escape the clutches of magical belief. That horrible darkness of magical belief. And continue to cultivate familiarity with the wow factor, and continue to cultivate familiarity and be attracted towards truth, of our being, which is that we are perfectly free, that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, as God created me. Very great. That is it.